Senate will come to order. The prayer today is offered by Reverend Rachel Byram, and the Pledge of Allegiance is led by Senate Pages Kinley Kirkley and Katie Sheridan, both from Faith.
Please pray with me. That to which we each recognize as the divine. In you we find the beginning and end of all knowledge. In you we seek all wisdom and all understanding. We ask you to bless us and consecrate this chamber. We pray that the gates of righteousness open before us here today, that we may enter and that our deliberations may bear enduring fruit. Give us the wisdom to honor those we serve. May our words shine with wisdom, so we may speak emboldened by the truth of our hearts. Let our judgment be lampposts upon the path before us. We bear the weight of truth and walk unflinchingly into the light before us. May our feet then trod with confidence as we and all South Dakotans walk boldly towards tomorrow. Amen.
Secretary will call the roll.
Senator Beal, Boland, Bordeaux, Breitling, Castleberry, Crabtree, Davis, Dybert, Diedrich, Duhamel, Foster, Fry, Mueller, Hoffman, Hunoff, Johnson, Klum, Colbeck, Jack, Colbeck, Steve, Larson, Maher, Melhoff, Nesseba, Norstra, Botten, Pischke, Reed, Roll, Schoenbeck, Shanefish, Dalzer, Tobin, Wheeler, Wick, Wink, and Zickman. We have a quorum, Mr. President.
Thank you. Today's doctor of the day, again, is Noel Shequin, MD. Dr. Shequin, are you in the gallery? Guess not. Well, we'll hold off on that. Approval of the journal.
Mr. President, The Committee on Legislative Procedure respectfully reports that the Secretary of the Senate has had under consideration the Senate Journal of the 22nd day. All errors, typographical or otherwise, are duly marked in the temporary journal for correction, and we hereby move the adoption of the report. Respectfully submitted, Senator Schoenbeck, Chair.
Comments on that motion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Senator Wick.
Mr. President, I wish to invoke Rule 6H-4 in regards to Senate Commemoration 810 on today's calendar.
Second. As duly noted. I would take a personal privilege and introduce a former member of this chamber. Welcome back. Senator Troy Hinert, thank you for being here. Any personal privileges before we get started? Yes, Senator Bordeaux.
Personal privilege?
Granted.
Thank you. I have two of them, if that's okay.
Granted.
Thank you. Today in the gallery, we have the JAG students from across the state, Jobs for America's graduates. They are some of the best and brightest students in the state. Please help me welcome them to the Senate chambers.
Welcome.
Please stand up. Thank you. Also in the gallery, we have St. Joseph Indian School in Chamberlain, their teacher Dave Baldwin, Nathan Hislaw Sr., teacher aide, Matt Mohan, the math teacher, and Sarah Moran, the science teacher. Please welcome the eighth graders who are here today in the Capitol.
Welcome to the Senate. Reports of standing committees.
Mr. President, the Committee on Senate Ag and Natural Resources met. They had under consideration Senate Bill 185, which was amended, and then after amending, they recommend that it do pass. Respectfully submitted, Senator Otten, Chair. The Committee on Senate Education had under consideration Senate Bill 65, which was deferred to the 41st legislative day, and they recommend a do pass for Senate Bill 129. Respectfully submitted, Senator Shane Fish, Chair. The Committee on Senate Military and Veterans Affairs had under consideration Senate Bill 186, which was tabled. And then they had under consideration the nomination of Greg Whitlock of Watertown to the position of Secretary of the Department of Veterans Affairs. And they recommend that the Senate advise and consent to the confirmation of this reappointment and that it be placed on the consent calendar. House Bill 1084, they recommend do pass and be placed on the consent calendar. And HCR 6003 was deferred to the 41st legislative day. Respectfully submitted, Senator Johnson, Chair. The Committee on Judiciary had under consideration Senate Bill 94, which was tabled, and Senate Bill 134 and 206. They were both amended, and they recommend do pass and then to be placed on the consent calendar. Senate Bill 181 recommend do pass, and Senate Bill 192 was deferred to the 41st legislative day. Respectfully submitted, Senator Duhamel, Chair. And the Committee on Commerce and Energy had under consideration Senate Bill 120, which was amended, and then after amending, they recommend that it do pass. And Senate Bill 194, which was deferred to the 41st legislative day. They also had under consideration the nomination of Michael Houdyshell of Peer to the position of Secretary of the Department of Revenue, and they returned with the recommendation that the Senate advise and consent to the confirmation of said appointment. Respectfully submitted, Senator Wheeler, Chair.
Messages.
Mr. President, I have the honor to transmit House Bill 1008, 1009, 1135, 1154, 1155, 1158, 1176, 1189, and 1193, which have passed the House and your favorable consideration is requested. And I have the honor to return Senate Bill 84, which has passed the House without change. Respectfully, Pat Miller, Chief Clerk.
Consideration of committee reports.
Senator Crabtree moves that the reports of the Standing Committee on State Affairs on Senate Bill 40 be adopted.
Second.
Comments on that motion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. First reading of House bills.
House Bill 1008, an act to revise provisions relating to actuarial terminology used by the South Dakota retirement system. 1009, an act to update and clarify certain provisions relating to the South Dakota retirement system. 1135, an act to provide for transparency in the pricing of prescription drugs. 1154, an act to modify acceptable conduct for practitioners related to medical cannabis. 1155, an act to add dental practices as eligible facilities to participate in the Rural Healthcare Recruitment Assistance Program. 1158, an act to ban counterfeit airbags. 1176, an act to revise certain provisions regarding on-sale alcoholic beverage licenses for use at municipality-owned facilities. 1189, an act to require certain entities owning agricultural land to report foreign beneficial ownership interests. And House Bill 1193, an act to amend provisions of the Uniform Commercial Code.
Those bills, having had their first reading, are assigned as follows. Senate Ag and Natural Resources gets House Bill 1189. Senate Commerce and Energy, House Bill 1193. Senate Health and Human Services gets House Bill 1135, 1154, and 1155. Senate Local Government gets House Bill 1176. Senate Retirement Laws gets House Bill 1008 and 1009. Senate Transportation gets House Bill 1158. Second reading of Senate bills.
Senate Bill 25, an act to make an appropriation to reimburse health care professionals who have complied with the requirements for health care recruitment assistance programs and to declare an emergency.
Senate Bill 25, having had its second reading, is up for consideration and final passage. Are there any remarks? Senator Breitling.
Thank you, Mr. President. Senate Bill 25 is a rural recruitment assistance program, and it's actually divided into two pieces. The first one is a recruitment assistance program for physicians, physicians assistants, nurse practitioners, nurse midwives, certified registered nurse, and certified registered nurse anesthetists. Participants in the program agree to practice in the community for 3 years, at the end of which they will receive an incentive payment. Physicians and dentists receive an amount equal to twice the USD School of Medicine resident tuition during the first 4 years. PAs, NPs, nurse midwives, and CRNAs receive an amount equal to twice the USD resident tuition for PA studies for the three most recent completed academic years. The percent of the incentive payment for the state must that participates in is based on community size. For communities having a population of 2,500 or less, the state's portion is 75%. For communities of more than 25 but less than 5,000, the state's share is 50%. And for communities 5,000 to 10,000, the state share is 25%. Communities above a population of 10,000 are not eligible. This bill appropriates $1,261 to the Department of Health to reimburse four physicians, two dentists, and two PAs who have fulfilled the requirements of their agreements with the state during fiscal year 24. The retention rates are high. A total of 69% of the physicians have remained in those communities, 80% of the dentists, and 64% of the PAs, nurse practitioners, and nurse midwives, and CRNAs. The second piece of this bill is the Rural Healthcare Facility Recruitment Assistance Program. Eligible professions receive an incentive payment of $10,000 upon completion of a three-year practice commitment to the facility. Participating facilities are required to pay their portion as defined earlier as well. Up to 60 healthcare professionals can participate in the program on any given year. This year, the appropriation is $284,999 to the Department of Health for 48 eligible healthcare professionals who have met those requirements. Those include RNs, LPNs, lab techs, occupational therapists, physical therapists, and rad techs. The total general funds needed to reimburse the eligible professionals who have complied with the requirements is a general fund request of $1,285,260. I appreciate your support on Senate Bill 25.
Further remarks on Senate Bill 25? Hearing none, the question before the Senate is final passage of Senate Bill 25. Members in favor vote aye, those opposed nay. This is a two-thirds majority vote. Secretary will call the roll.
Senator Beal?
Aye.
Bolin?
Aye.
Bordeaux?
Aye.
Breitling?
Aye.
Castleberry?
Aye.
Crabtree?
Aye.
Davis?
Aye.
Dibert?
Aye.
Diedrich?
Aye.
Duhamel?
Aye.
Foster?
Aye.
Freimuller?
No.
Hoffman?
Yes.
Hunoff?
Aye.
Johnson?
Aye.
Klum? Kolbeck Jack?
Aye.
Kolbeck Steve?
Aye.
Larson?
Aye.
Maher?
Aye.
Melhoff?
Aye.
Nessaba?
Aye.
Nordstrup?
Aye.
Otten?
Aye.
Pischke?
No.
Reed?
Aye.
Roll?
Aye.
Schoenbeck?
Aye.
Shanefish?
Aye.
Stalzer?
Aye.
Tobin?
Aye.
Wheeler?
Aye.
Wick?
Aye.
Wink?
Sickman? Aye.
Mr. President, there are 33 yeas, 2 nays.
Senate Bill 25, having received an affirmative vote of two-thirds of the majority of members elect, is hereby declared passed. Any questions on the title? Hearing none, title deemed correct.
Senate Bill 108, an act to provide an educational exception to consumption prohibitions for persons over 18 years of age who are required to taste an alcoholic beverage as part of a course.
Senate Bill 108, having had its second readings up for consideration and final passage, are there any remarks?
Mr. President.
Senator Nesba.
Thank you, Mr. President. Back in January, my good colleague across the aisle here was asked a question about what's going to be the most important thing we talk about this session. And the good senator from America's hometown said, workforce, workforce, workforce. And that's what Senate Bill 108 is about. It's about workforce. So this is about allowing our educational institutions to be able to be more nimble to meet the needs of industry and the number of breweries, distilleries, and wineries across the state. So this is mostly about those breweries, wineries, and distilleries, but at the same time, we do have biotech companies like Poet and Prairie Aquatech and SAB Therapeutics that also need an educated workforce that understands the fermentation process. The problem is that although you can use lab tests to test acidity, the amount of alcohol in a substance, there's only one good tool to really use when you're trying to figure out the flavor, and that's a tongue. And so what this bill does, if you read Section 3, carves out a very narrow exception for students being able to do that under supervision in class. They would have to be 18 years of older. They have to be enrolled in an accredited college or university. They would be required to taste, but not consume or imbibe. During the testimony, what we talked about was sipping and spitting, right? Being able to taste it to see what you're, what it is that you're brewing in that brewing class or in that winemaking class. And this section only applies if the alcoholic beverage tasted for instructional purposes remains in the possession and control of an authorized instructor of the college or university who is 21 years of age or older. So this is a very narrow carve out to allow our college institutions to be able to meet the workforce needs of the firms in your districts. So thank you, Mr. President.
Further remarks on Senate Bill 108. Senator Reed.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just almost said speaker. I'm getting over that. So I stand in opposition of Senate Bill 108. I worked on the original bill that allowed universities to manufacture and experiment with wine, beer, and spirits. Now, it's true that some of this comes in, you know, some of it's put together because of bioproducts, okay? But if you're making bioproducts, you're not tasting. You're not tasting anything. This isn't about when it's brewed, it's more about the content of proteins in it. It's about, can you turn it into a plastic? That's what bioproducts are. This is just about alcohol, drinking alcohol. This is about making spirits. Now, there's no reason why a student can't wait until they're 21 to take these classes. They can't go into the workforce until they're 21. So I don't believe that this is a good bill. I think it's just one way of being able to serve some alcohol on campus. And so I would ask for your opposition to Senate Bill 108.
Further remarks on Senate Bill 108. Senator Colbeck.
Thank you, Mr. President. Members of the Senate body, I've been involved in the beverage business since I was in high school and college in 1972. At that time, I was 18 years of age, and at that time, I could consume an alcoholic beverage legally. With this bill here, I think we're just opening up the door to allow an 18-year-old to sip a beer, taste a beer, sample the beer while his instructor is not in the room or whatever, and just enhances the possibility of them going back out on the street. They can wait until they're 21 to come into this class. It's not the class that takes 4 years to do. We in our industry have done a lot over the many, many years to show responsibility to the citizens and to our industry. We know as an industry we can be legislative out of business overnight. We know that. And we have taken steps within our organization, our South Dakota Beer Distributors Association, our NBWA, National Beer Wholesalers Association, not only to protect our business, but also to protect our young people here in the country. We know we sell a beverage, and we call it a beverage of moderation, we call it a beverage of fun. And we would prefer to have every person that could legally consume an alcoholic beverage be around at the age of 21 to enjoy that. So with all that we have done over the past few years, I feel this is an unnecessary step in the process of teaching young people how to make a beer or a wine or a liquor. I think they can wait until they're 21, just like I would like to see them wait until they're 21 to purchase a beer out in our great state of South Dakota. I ask you to vote no on this bill. Thank you.
Further remarks? Any member wish to speak before Senator Nesba speaks a second time in closing? Hearing none, Senator Nesba in closing.
Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you for those comments and those concerns, and let me address both of them, that this is not about allowing 18-year-olds to drink. This is about allowing them to learn a process, to be able to be trained so that they have the skills and the understandings of fermentation to go and work for firms in your districts. And the problem is that they can't wait. One of the people who testified said this: as most four-year college students start college at around the age of 18 and finish around the age of 21, their current ability to participate in courses related to fermentation or culinary products is extremely time-limited. This complicates academic planning for them, limits their enrollment in these classes, and thus the development of the desired workforce. So, again, this is a bill trying to deal with our workforce shortages, which we hear about in this floor almost every day, and I would ask for your support for Senate Bill 108. Thank you.
Hearing no further remarks, the question before the Senate is final passage of Senate Bill 108. Members in favor will vote aye, those opposed nay. Secretary will please call the roll.
Senator Beal?
Nay.
Bolin?
No.
Bordeaux?
Aye.
Breitling?
No.
Castleberry?
Aye.
Crabtree? Davis?
No.
Dibert?
No.
Diedrich?
No.
Duhamel?
No.
Foster?
Aye.
Freimuller?
Yes.
Hoffman?
Yes.
Hunoff?
No.
Johnson?
Aye.
Klum?
No.
Kobach Jack?
No.
Kobach Steve?
Aye.
Larson?
Aye.
Maher?
Aye.
Melhoff?
No.
Nessebe?
Aye.
Nordstrup?
No.
Otten?
Aye.
Fischke?
Aye.
Reed?
No.
Roll?
Aye.
Schoenbeck?
Aye.
Shane Fish?
Aye.
Stalzer?
No.
Tobin?
Aye.
Wheeler?
Aye.
Wick?
No.
Wink?
No.
Zickman?
No.
Freimuller? Mr. President, there are 18 yeas, 17 nays.
Senate Bill 108, having received an affirmative vote of the majority of members elect, is hereby declared passed.
Senate Bill 197, an act to prohibit the spouse of a member of the legislature from being employed as a private lobbyist.
Senate Bill 197, having had a second readings up for consideration and final passage, are there any remarks? Senator Roll.
Thank you, Mr. President. Senate Bill 197, I think, closes a loophole that should have been closed a long time ago, and honestly, the voters did try to close it once. But what it essentially does is it says that if you are the spouse of a sitting legislator, you can't be a lobbyist, or you can't be an employed lobbyist. And the reason that I think that's so important is twofold. One, I think it does create confusion, whether it be for our pages, our the LRC staff, the sergeant at arms, even fellow legislators. It's confusing how they're operating or when they're operating under which title and get which benefit. But more importantly and secondly, I think it opens a huge loophole in our system to be able to pass financial gain onto a legislator. Spouses are one legal entity. To an actual legislator, they often share bank accounts. They have greater access. And I could tell you that if I was not in the legislature and I wanted to get something lobbied, I would certainly hire a spouse of a lobbyist because they would have that greater access and that greater availability. I think it's a dangerous loophole that we have in our system, and I think it's something that's supported by the people in our state. Do I think this closes every loophole out there in the world? No. But this is an important step, I think, to actually showing the people that PEER is capable of reform, and we're capable of fixing loopholes, and we're capable of monitoring ourselves, and I think this is a great example of a situation where we can do that. It would be extremely easy to be able to hire a spouse to lobby on behalf of something for you, and that money be easily transferred to a legislator. A legislator is not allowed to lobby. They're not allowed to lobby while they're in the Senate or in the House, and they're not allowed to lobby for a few years afterwards. I think it is a common sense notion that we would also say the spouse of a lobbyist wouldn't be able to do those same functions.
So with that being said, I hope you guys will support Senate Bill 197. I think it's a fair step. I think it creates accountability, and I think it puts a guardrail into a system that needs it. Thank you.
Further remarks? Senator Mueller.
Senator Frymuller, please.
Pardon me?
Senator Frymuller, please.
Senator Frymuller.
Thank you. This bill does leave people with certain perceptions on why this was brought. This bill focuses on the private lobbyist only as it relates to legislators and their spouses, yet it exempts all state employees' spouses in either the executive branch or judicial branch. Does that show discrimination? I believe it does. As legislators, we are in session making laws approximately 2 months out of a year, and I would say that lobbyists that are related to full-time state employees, such as the former Secretary of Education married to South Dakota retailers lobbyist, for example, would have a potential impact year-round. What about either immediate family of a legislator or extended family of a legislator? The House Majority Leader has a family member that's been a paid lobbyist during his entire legislative service. I'm not implying improper behavior, but what is the difference of opportunity between them? Are we going to also pursue legislators who are related and serving simultaneously? We have husbands and wives, fathers and daughters, cousins, formerly mother and son, who are either currently serving or have served simultaneously. The senator from Pennington County asked in committee about unpaid lobbyists or lobbyists that did not receive direct or indirect benefits from an organization. As the bill reads, no person may be employed as a registered private lobbyist. The forms that are filled out by lobbyists are titled as employee or employer only, regardless of either being paid or unpaid volunteered lobbyists. This bill does not define that aspect clearly. I would suggest volunteer lobbyists fill out a different form to define their role differently than paid lobbyists. For your information, my husband, Mike Mueller, is a volunteer lobbyist for South Dakota Citizens for Liberty, which is made up of 100% volunteers who work for We the People. He has testified for years as a citizen with no repercussions. Since a committee discussion between Senator from Pennington County and the prime sponsor pertained to lobbyist or legislator receiving benefit from a private organization to be perceived as a conflict, no pay or perks are received for this particular volunteer's lobbyist actions, and there's zero financial benefit when you volunteer. As our constitutional First Amendment affords us five freedoms of speech, press, petitioning our government for redress of grievances, peaceable assembly, and the practice of religion. Several of these will be abridged if this bill passes. In closing, I've only skimmed the surface of potential conflicts of interest between lobbyists and any branch of government. But this apparently is focused and conspicuously timed approach to target a volunteer lobbyist should ignite some soul searching within every member of this body. For the benefit of the people of South Dakota, I urge you to resist this bill. Thank you.
Further remarks on Senate Bill 197? Any member wish to speak before Senator Roll speaks a second time in closing? Hearing none, Senator Roll in closing.
Thank you, Mr. President. Well, those weren't stated as a question, and I wish they were, but I can certainly address the ones that I was able to scribble down while we were going through. As far as the judicial and executive branch, there's a very clear reason why they weren't included, and that's because the primary concern in this is not being able to distinguish between the two, as well as the financial aspect. If you're a lobbyist for the executive branch or for the judicial branch, you're a state employee, and all that information is already available to the public. It's also easily identifiable. I believe it's not really related to the bill, but it was brought up, so I'll mention it. But legislators that are serving simultaneously with their spouses, both spouses were elected by the people to come out here and serve, so I guess I wouldn't put that as an argument against. And finally, as far as immediate family extending out, I'll certainly admit there's situations in law where we do that with other industries, but the reason that this was targeted specifically to a spouse and not an entire immediate family is because a son can't sign a parent's name. A son can't open a bank account and share it with an individual without the other person being there. It would have to be a mutual thing that they both agreed to. Like I said in my opening, there's certainly other areas that you can scam a system and break a system, but that doesn't mean that you shouldn't fix a hole when you see it. And I believe this is a clear hole. The previous speaker had implied that this is somehow a bill to stop one individual from testifying, and that's just not the case. It's a much larger package, and I'll note, nothing in this bill would stop that particular individual or any individual from being able to come testify in front of a committee. Any citizen can come testify in front of a committee. You don't even have to be a citizen. We certainly welcome it. We're saying you can't be paid, you can't be employed to come out here and testify on behalf or to promote on behalf of an organization because of the relationship that you have pre-established that's legally recognized as two people joining together as one. I think it's a problem when we regulate the good senator from Sioux Falls business significantly more than we regulate ourselves in peer. And I think this would be a good example of holding ourselves to the same standard we expect business to hold themselves to. Any lawyer that was a spouse would never be able to take that because it would be a conflict of interest and they're tied to those same ethics. Non-attorneys wouldn't be tied to those ethics. So I think it's really important that the state legislature as a whole continues to say that not only do we put trust and faith in our elections, we put trust and faith in our process. So for that, please support Senate Bill 197. Thank you.
Hearing no further remarks, the question before the Senate is final passage of Senate Bill 197. Members in favor vote aye. Those opposed nay. Secretary will call the roll.
Senator Beal?
No.
Bolin?
Aye.
Bordeaux?
Aye.
Breitling?
Aye.
Castleberry?
No.
Crabtree?
Aye.
Davis?
Aye.
Dibert?
Aye.
Diedrich?
Aye.
Duhamel?
Aye.
Foster? Freimuller?
No.
Hoffman?
Yes.
Hunoff?
No.
Johnson?
Aye.
Klum?
Aye.
Kolbeck Jack?
Aye.
Kolbeck Steve?
No.
Larson?
Aye.
Maher?
Aye.
Melhoff?
No.
Nessaba?
Aye.
Nordstrup?
Aye.
Otten?
Aye.
Pischke?
Pass.
Reed?
Roll? Aye.
Schoenbeck?
Aye.
Jane Fish?
No.
Stalzer?
Aye.
Tobin?
Aye.
Wheeler?
No.
Wick?
No.
Wink?
No.
Zickman?
No.
Foster?
No.
Pischke?
No.
Mr. President, there are 22 yeas, 13 nays.
Senate Bill 197, having received an affirmative vote of the majority of members elect, is hereby declared passed. Any questions on the title? Hearing none, title deemed correct.
Senate Bill 103, an act to create a pilot program in the unified judicial system for risk and lethality assessments for certain persons accused of assault or protection order violations.
Senate Bill 103, having had its second readings up for consideration and final passage, are there any remarks? Senator Schoenbeck.
Thank you, Mr. President, members of the body. This is a task for or a pilot project that the UJS is supportive of. It has no cost. It's about a unique area of the criminal code. It's been said that most of the criminal code dates back to the time of Cain and Abel, but one of the newer parts with less history would relate to domestic abuse. This relates to protection orders and assaults of individuals and relationships, and it's about using tools that already are in existence and being used some places in South Dakota to do a lethality assessment, risk and lethality, tough word to say. If we can do this, they're going to find if the tools work, it'll help the judicial branch in properly handling these types of criminal offenses. Thank you.
Further remarks on Senate Bill 103. Senator Freimuller.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just had pulled this off the consent calendar yesterday because I thought there should be a fiscal note attached to this. So I just didn't know how it was going to be paid for, if you're creating a new program, and then whether or not it's going to continue. I just have concerns on that. So I was wondering if the prime sponsor can verify for sure that there will be no cost to this. Thank you.
So that was a form of a question. Senator Schoenbeck, do you wish to answer? Senator Schoenbeck.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you for the question. There is no cost to it. The UJS has testified to that. It's just using tools that are readily available already on a pilot project in some parts of the state.
Further remarks? Hearing no further remarks, the question before the Senate is final passage of Senate Bill 103. Members in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, nay. Secretary will call the roll.
Senator Beal?
Aye.
Boland?
Aye.
Bordeaux?
Aye.
Breitling?
Aye.
Castleberry?
Aye.
Crabtree?
Aye.
Pardon?
Aye.
Davis?
Aye.
Dibert?
Aye.
Diedrich?
Aye.
Duhamel?
Aye.
Foster?
Aye.
Freimuller?
Aye.
Hoffman?
Yes.
Hanov?
Aye.
Johnson?
Aye.
Klum?
Aye.
Colbeck Jack?
Aye.
Colbeck Steve? Larson?
Aye.
Maher?
Aye.
Melhoff?
Aye.
Nessaba?
Aye.
Nordstrup?
Aye.
Otten?
Aye.
Pischke?
No.
Reed?
Aye.
Roll?
Aye.
Schoenbeck?
Aye.
Shanefish?
Aye.
Stalzer?
Aye.
Tobin?
Aye.
Wheeler?
Aye.
Wick?
Aye.
Wink?
Aye.
Zickman? Mr. President, there are 34 yeas, one nay.
Senate Bill 103, having received an affirmative vote from the majority of members elect, is hereby declared passed. Any questions on the title? Hearing none, title deemed correct. Senator Nesba.
Thank you, Mr. President. Could I have a personal privilege, please?
Granted.
Great, thank you. Up in our gallery today, there are a number of folks from various organizations that are here for Equality Visibility Day in the Capitol. I'd ask them to stand up. There's folks here from Equality South Dakota, the Transformation Project, Sioux Falls Pride, South Dakota Youth Activism, Black Hills Center for Equality, ACLU South Dakota, and hopefully I didn't miss any of those. And I would just like to offer them a thank you for the roast beef, mashed potatoes, and corn that they had in the rotunda today for lunch. So a big thank you. Welcome to your Senate.
And I would also like to say thank you to the Sioux Falls Specialty Hospital for providing breakfast in the President's Speaker's Lobby. And also a thank you to the Cannabis Industry Association of South Dakota for providing lunch in the President's Speaker's lobbies. No brownies this year. Oh well. Second reading of House Bills.
House Bill 1101, an act to ensure the proper labeling of American Indian arts and crafts.
House Bill 1101, having had a second reading, is up for consideration and final passage. Are there any remarks? Senator Roll.
Thank you, Mr. President. House Bill 1101 seeks to change the language from similar to purports to be in this bill, and essentially the effects of that simple language change protects American Indian artists as well as provides clarity to businesses. This is a bill that was supported by the retailers, and essentially it's changing a law that we've had on our books for decades that has never once been successfully charged. And the reason it's never been charged is because it's such a vague statute that anything can anything could be similar to an artifact. You can make an argument either way. Where now we're going to provide more clarity to the law and make it say it purports to be or it claims to be, providing that better clarity, which will A, give better direction to businesses, and B, helps Native American artists be able to sell their art as being authentic. So I'd ask you to please support the bill. Thank you.
Further remarks? Senator Nesba.
Yeah, thank you. Just a question for the prime sponsor.
State your question.
So my understanding is that this is also adjudicated at the federal level. Is this change keeping our law consistent with the federal statute?
Is there a role you wish to answer?
Yeah. Yes, to my knowledge, it is.
Further remarks?
Mr. President.
Senator Diedrich.
Thank you. I'd just add clarification to that. Actually, the federal law is significantly more, the punishment is significantly greater than what our state law would do. So the federal law, if you look at it, it's really the Indian Arts and Crafts Act of 1990. And the says it's illegal to offer, display for sale, or sell any art or craft product in a manner that falsely suggests it is Indian produced, an Indian product, or the product of a particular Indian or Indian tribe or Indian arts and crafts organization within the United States. And first time violation individual could face is civil or criminal prosecution up to $250,000 fine. Or a 5-year prison term, and it's even larger for a business. The only reason I express an interest in this is because, out in the Black Hills area, there's a lot of Indian arts and crafts, and we do have some really nice galleries, and they all have the tag that's required. Typically, if it's truly an Indian art or craft that meets the federal requirements, it has tags on it that say that, so that you as a consumer aren't mistakenly purchasing a knockoff or something that's not authentic. And I haven't seen any issues within Prairie's Edge, which I think most of us probably know what that is and how beautiful it is and what a great marketplace it is. But I haven't seen a lot of violations or any concerns about it there. But the only reason I knew the penalty is I quick looked it up because I purchased articles from there, and I always look at those tags before I do to ensure that it is authentic and the dollars are going where they should go.
Further remarks? Hearing none, the question before the Senate is final passage of House Bill 1101. Members in favor will vote aye, those opposed nay. Secretary will call the roll.
Senator Beal?
Aye.
Bolin?
Yes.
Bordeaux?
Aye.
Breitling?
Aye.
Castleberry?
Aye.
Crabtree?
Aye.
Davis?
Aye.
Dibert?
Aye.
Diedrich?
Aye.
Duhamel?
Aye.
Foster? Freimuller?
Aye.
Hoffman?
Yes.
Hunoff?
Aye.
Johnson?
Aye.
Klum?
Aye.
Kolbeck Jack?
Aye.
Kolbeck Steve?
Aye.
Larson?
Aye.
Maher?
Aye.
Melhoff?
Aye.
Nessaba?
Aye.
Nordstrup?
Aye.
Otten?
Aye.
Fischke?
Aye.
Reed?
Aye.
Roll?
Aye.
Schoenbeck?
Aye.
Shanefish?
Aye.
Stalzer? Tobin?
Aye.
Wheeler?
Aye.
Wick?
Aye.
Wink?
Aye.
Zickman?
Aye.
Foster?
No.
Mr. President, there are 34 yeas, one nay.
House Bill 1101, having received an affirmative vote from the majority of members elect, is hereby declared passed. Any questions on the title? Hearing none, title's deemed correct. Senator Breitling.
Personal privilege?
Granted.
Thank you, Mr. President. With us today, the Mulbridge senior class has traveled down here to join us and observe some of our events today. I'd like to recognize Mulbridge.
Stand, please. Welcome to the Senate. And the doctor of the day is Dr. Noel Shequin, originally from Elk Point. Dr. Shequin is a family medicine physician who recently retired from Sanford Clinic. Welcome back to the Senate again. Thank you for your service. Announcements. Senator Klum.
Senate Transportation at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning. Senator Beal.
Senator Breitling.
Thank you, Mr. President. Later on this afternoon, we will have the Revenue Subcommittee in room 362. Tomorrow morning at 8, we will have the adoption of the revenue targets, and at 8:45, Joint Appropriations will hear bills. Thank you.
Senator Reed.
Senate Local Government, tomorrow at 10 a.m., we just have one bill.
Senator Tobin.
Senate Health and Human Services will meet tomorrow at 7:45 a.m., and we'll resume after session to finish our bills. Thank you.
Senator Hoffman.
Taxation Committee meeting in room 423 at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning, considering one bill.
Senator Northrup.
Capital Commission, 8 o'clock, Perkins Knight. Thank you.
Any other announcements? Madam Secretary.
Senator Bordeaux moves that the Senate do now adjourn.
All in favor of the motion to adjourn will say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Senate is adjourned.